This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at CR College and author of Managerial Accounting. In this video, we're going to look at the three schedules that are necessary to prepare an income statement for a manufacturing company. More specifically, these are the three schedules that lead into figuring out the amount of cost of goods sold that appears on the income statement. So the first schedule that we'll take a look at is the schedule of raw materials placed into production. The second schedule, and this is in chronological order, the second schedule is the schedule of cost of goods manufactured, and the third schedule is the schedule of cost of goods sold. Before we look at these schedules, we're going to take a look at the inventory cost equation because it's used for each of the three schedules that we're going to look at shortly. The inventory cost equation is as follows. We take our beginning balance in the specific inventory account that we're looking at. So we're going to use this inventory equation for each of the three inventory accounts: raw materials inventory, work in process inventory, and finished goods inventory. So we're going to look at the beginning balance, let's say for raw materials inventory. We're going to add to that any transfers in, which would be in a raw materials inventory situation, any purchases of raw materials. And then we're going to subtract from that the ending balance in raw materials, and that will give us what was transferred out over into work in process inventory. We'll go through the same process with the work in process inventory account and with the finished goods inventory account, and I'll show you that next. Now, there's a lot of information on this slide. I wanted to show you the big picture first before we zoom in and take a look at each of the individual schedules that lead into the income statement. But what we have here is an example for a company called Custom Furniture Company. This is the example that I use in my book. Let's assume that Custom Furniture Company produces custom wood furniture, or nice custom wood tables, nice custom wood chairs, those types of things. And what you'll see here is at the very top, this schedule up here is the schedule of raw materials placed in production. The second schedule is the schedule of cost of goods manufactured. The third schedule and final schedule is the schedule of cost of goods sold, and this then gives us the number, the amount that we need for cost of goods sold on the income statement. So again, this is the big picture. Now let's take a look at the details of each of these schedules so you get a sense of how each of these schedules is structured. Let's take a closer look at the first schedule in all of the schedules that lead into the income statement. So the first schedule is the schedule of raw materials placed in production. Let me zoom in a little further here so you can see it. And the schedule of raw materials placed in production, you can see the name here, is the schedule that tells us the amount that is of materials that are actually placed into production from the raw materials warehouse. So we start again using our equation of beginning balance plus transfers in minus ending balance equals transfers out. We start with raw materials beginning balance of $25,000. And the footnotes to all of this are at the very bottom of the schedule that we can look at later. But here's the beginning balance of $25,000 in the raw materials inventory account. Remember, this appears on the balance sheet, so it's not hard to find this information for most manufacturing companies. And then we're going to add to that our current period raw materials that we purchased. And we will get a subtotal and then subtract from that this $19,000 that you see here of the that represents the ending balance in raw materials, and that'll tell us then what was transferred out, which turns out to be $21,000. So again, we have our beginning balance of $25,000. We purchased $15,000 worth of raw materials, so we have $40,000 available, and of that $40,000, some of that's going to get placed in production and some of it's not. The part that was not placed in production is right here, the $19,000, and we subtract then that $19,000 from the $40,000 that was available, and that tells us then that we put $21,000 into production, worth of raw materials, into production. Remember, some of that, the raw materials placed in production is related to indirect materials, and again, we're back to custom furniture and woodworking, and that might be things like glue and nails that we used in production. Those are the indirect materials, and those are already in manufacturing overhead, so we're going to subtract that $3,000. And that tells us then $21,000 minus the $3,000, that $18,000 of direct materials were actually placed in production. So this first schedule relates to the raw materials inventory account. So I'm going to write that over here on the right side. I'll abbreviate. This relates to raw materials inventory. Now we're going to look at the second schedule, which relates to work in process inventory. And let me try to zoom in on this one as well so you can see this a little more clearly. This is the schedule of cost of goods manufactured. And what you see here is the same equation, beginning balance plus transfers in minus the ending balance equals the transfers out. So you see the same equation being used here, and you're going to see it again in the next schedule as well. So work in process inventory, we're going to look at the $35,000 as our, that's our beginning balance, and then we want to figure out what was transferred in. And remember, once we get to work in process, we have three elements that are being transferred in. We've got direct materials, we've got the direct labor, and we have manufacturing overhead. The direct materials, we just figured that out. We just figured out that $18,000 was transferred in from up above, and you can see the arrow there. And then we've got direct labor, and that's not hard to get. We can take a look at the timesheets for the people that are working within the production facility. And $40,000 was the payroll for those folks. And then we have, so you see that here, and then we have the manufacturing overhead amount. Remember all those other factory costs like factory insurance and indirect materials, indirect labor, and that was $96,000. So the total of these three items is $154,000. That represents the costs that were transferred in to work in process during the period. If you add that $154,000 to the $35,000 up here, that then comes out to $189,000 of total cost of work in process. Now, some of that work in process is still going to be there at the end of the period, and some of that work in process, those goods, will be completed and transferred out. So we're going to do a count of work in process at the end of the period, and we determined that we had $28,000 worth of goods still in work in process at the end of the period. So $189,000 minus that $28,000 gives us what was transferred out. And we had $161,000 of products that were completed during the period and transferred out of work in process and taken over into finished goods inventory. Okay, now I've pulled back out on this schedule so that you can see the next schedule that we're going to focus on, which relates to finished goods inventory. And we're going to be using the same schedule, the same equation that we used before, beginning balance plus transfers in minus ending balance equals transfers out. So let me now zoom into this schedule again that relates to finished goods. And ultimately we're trying to determine the cost of goods sold, so we call this a schedule of cost of goods sold. You'll notice here again that we start with the beginning balance for finished goods of $90,000. We add to that the $161,000 that we calculated up above. Here's that, remember the 161 up here. We bring that down, and that's what was transferred out of work in process over into finished goods inventory. That's what we're looking at right now, finished goods inventory. So we add the 161,000 to the 90,000 that was already in finished goods inventory, and that gives us the cost of goods available for sale of $251,000. I'm going to say the same thing here that I did with the two schedules prior to this. We're either going to sell these goods that cost $251,000 for us to build, or we're not. We're going to still have them in inventory. So if the ending balance here of $116,000 represents the amount that was still in ending inventory at the end of the period. If we subtract that from the $251,000, that tells us that we actually sold goods worth, or not worth, but that cost us $135,000. And ultimately, that's what we're trying to get at, is cost of goods sold with these three schedules that's going to go right down into the income statement that we'll take a look at next. Now, you have all the footnotes here. I'm not going to go through each of these footnotes, but you can take a look at them on your own if you like. You can pause and take a look at these footnotes if you'd like to clarify what they represent. But I think I've talked about virtually all of them in this video. Okay, again, I've pulled way back here to show you how all of these three schedules lead into the income statement that you see right here. So at the very top, we have an analysis of raw materials inventory and what was placed into production. Below that, we have the schedule of cost of goods manufactured that tells us what was placed, ultimately, the cost of the goods that were completed and transferred into finished goods. And then below that, we show what was actually sold and transferred over into cost of goods sold, which ends up on the income statement. So now we're on the income statement, and I'm going to zoom in on that a bit so you can see how these relate. And here's your income statement. And if you look at this carefully, you'll see that this $135,000 here comes right down here to the income statement. And that's our cost of goods sold. So that's why we're putting these three schedules together to be able to determine our cost of goods sold amount. And then the rest of this information comes from our books. So we had sales of $190,000. Cost of goods sold was the key number, $135,000. Subtract that to get our gross profit. We have, of course, our non-manufacturing expenses down below, selling and general and administrative, and we ended up with an operating profit of $11,000. So this summarizes for you the three different supporting schedules in a manufacturing setting that help us to determine our cost of goods sold amount, which appears on the income statement.